Livy. Book 35. 1. At the start of the year in which these things occurred, Sextus Digitus, who was praetor in Hither Spain, fought with the communities who had rebelled in large numbers after the departure of Marcus Cato. The battles were more numerous than they were worthy of record, and most went so badly for him that Digitius passed on to his successor barely half the men he had himself been given. Spelt capital D-I-G-I-T-I-U-S. Digitius. Not Digitus. From the top. At the start of the year in which these things occurred, Sextus Digitius, who was praetor in Hither Spain, fought with the communities who had rebelled in large numbers after the departure of Marcus Cato. The battles were more numerous than they were worthy of record, and most went so badly for him that Digitius passed on to his successor barely half the men he had himself been given. There is no doubt that the whole of Spain would have been encouraged by this, but for the other praetor, Publius Cornelius Scipio, son of Gnaeus Scipio. For he had fought many successful battles beyond the Ebro, intimidating no fewer than 50 towns into joining him. Such was Scipio's achievement as praetor. As proprietor, he also made an attack on the Lusitanians when they were actually on the road homeward, carrying enormous spoils after ravaging the farther province. He fought them from the third to the eighth hour of the day in an inconclusive engagement. For while he was no match for them numerically, he had the advantage in other respects. In joining battle, he had had his soldiers in a close-formed line which faced a column that was drawn out and encumbered by a herd of animals, and these were fresh troops facing men fatigued by a long march, for the enemy had set out at the third watch, and in addition to the journey during the night, there had been the 3 hours of daytime travel. And then the exertion of the march had been immediately followed by the battle, without a moment's respite. As a result, although the Lusitanians began to fight with a measure of energy and determination, and though they had initially thrown the Romans into disorder, it gradually became an evenly matched struggle. At this critical juncture, the commander made a vow of gains to Jupiter, contingent on his driving back and cutting down the enemy. Eventually, the Romans pushed ahead with greater ferocity, while the Lusitanians gave ground, and then actually turned tail. As the victors pressed their advantage against the fleeing Spaniards, some 12,000 of the enemy were cut down, 540 taken prisoner, almost all of them cavalry, and 134 military standards captured. Losses from the Roman army totaled 73. The battle was fought not far from the city of Ilippa, and it was to this town that Publius Cornelius brought back his conquering army with its ample spoils. These were all set out in front of the town, and owners were given the opportunity to identify what was theirs. The remainder was given to the quaestor to be sold, and the takings were distributed amongst the soldiers. 2. When these events were taking place in Spain, Gaius Flaminius had not yet left Rome, and so conversations between him and his friends centered more on the failures rather than the successes there. Since a serious war had flared up in the province, and since he was to take over from Sextus Digitius, the little that remained of the latter's army, which itself was full of fear and dejection, Flaminius had tried to have the Senate formally assign him one of the urban legions. To this, he would add the soldiers he had enrolled following the Senate's decree, and then select from the entire body a force of 6,200 infantry and 300 cavalry. This, he said, was the legion with which he would go into action, for little confidence could be placed in Sextus Digitius' army. The senior members replied that decrees of the Senate should not be passed in response to rumors foolishly concocted by private citizens to suit the purposes of magistrates, and insisted that no news could be considered official without written statements from praetors in the provinces, or reports from their legates. If there was a state of emergency existing in Spain, they said, then it was the Senate's decision that emergency troops be enrolled by the praetor outside Italy. What the Senate actually intended was that emergency troops be recruited in Spain. Valerius Antius records that Gaius Flaminius sailed to Sicily to raise troops, and that as he headed from Sicily to Spain, he was blown off course in a storm to Africa, where he swore in some stragglers from the army of Publius Africanus. To these levies, made in the two provinces, says Antius Flaminius, added a third undertaken in Spain. 3. In Italy, the war with the Ligurians was escalating just as quickly. Pisa was now under siege by 40,000 men, their numbers increasing every day as word of the war spread and hopes of plunder rose. The consul, Minucius, reached Arretium on the day on which he had ordered his men to muster. From there, he had led them to Pisa, a regular formation, and since the enemy had moved their camp to a point across the river and no more than a mile from the town, the consul entered a city that unquestionably owed its salvation to his arrival. In Pisae, spelt capital P-I-S-A-E. The next day, Minucius also crossed the river, pitching his camp about half a mile from the enemy. From this position, he fought some minor skirmishes, which protected the farmlands of the allies from plundering expeditions. But he would not risk a pitched battle. His men were raw recruits drawn from different tribes, who were not well enough acquainted to be able to rely on each other. The Ligurians, who had confidence in their numbers, offered pitched battle and were ready for a decisive confrontation. And since they had so many men, they also kept sending out numerous raiding parties in all directions along the borders of their territory. And when large quantities of animals and other plunder had been assembled, armed guards were at the ready to take them to their strongholds and villages. 4. The Ligurian War had thus come to a halt around Pisae. The other consul, Lucius Cornelius Marulla, now took his army along the borders of the Ligurians into the lands of the Boii, and here the tactics employed in the conflict differed greatly from those used with the Ligurians. It was now the consul who would offer battle, and the enemy who would decline. And when no one came out to face him, the Romans would split up to plunder, the Boii preferring to see their lands pillaged without resistance, then join battle protecting them. After effecting wholesale devastation by fire and the sword, the consul left enemy territory and led his men towards Multina, the column proceeding without caution, as if passing through pacified territory. When they became aware that their enemy had left their lands, the Boii proceeded to follow them, marching without noise and looking for a place to waylay them. During the night, they passed by the Roman camp and occupied a ravine through which the Romans had to proceed. They employed insufficient stealth in doing this, however, and the consul, who made a practice of striking camp in the dead of night, now waited for dawn so that the darkness would not intensify the men's panic in the disorderly engagement. Moreover, although he was moving camp at daybreak, he still sent ahead a cavalry squadron to reconnoitre. When a report of the size of the enemy force and its position came back, Marulla gave orders for the baggage of the entire column to be brought together in one spot and for the triarii to build a defense work around it. He then advanced on the enemy with the rest of his army drawn up for battle. The Gauls did the same after they saw that their ambush had been exposed and that they were obliged to fight a regular open battle in which honest courage would win the day. 5. The sides clashed about the second hour. The allied left wing and the irregular contingent were fighting in the front line under the command of two consular legates, Marcus Marcellus and Tiberius Sempronius, of whom the latter had been consul the previous year. The new consul would at one moment be at the front standards, and at the next he would be holding back the legions in reserve, preventing them from charging before the signal was given from eagerness for the fight. Marulla ordered the military tribunes, Quintus and Publius Minucius, to lead the cavalry of these legions outside the line to an open area, and to attack with them from the unimpeded ground when he gave the signal. While the consul was making these arrangements, word reached him from Tiberius Sempronius Longus that the irregulars could not hold out against the charge of the Gauls. Large numbers of them had been cut down, said Longus, and the survivors had lost their ardor for the fight through exhaustion or fear. He suggested the consul send help in from the one of the two legions, if he saw fit, before they were dealt an ignominious defeat. The second legion was sent in, and the irregulars withdrawn, with fresh troops joining in, and a legion with a full complement of companies arriving, life was now restored to the battle. The left wing was also withdrawn from the engagement, and the right replaced it in the front line. The sun now beat down with a fierce intensity on the Gauls, who were physically incapable of coping with heat, but with ranks closely ordered and leaning on one another or on their shields, they kept on parrying the Romans' assaults. When the consul saw this, he instructed Gaius Livius Salinator, commander of the allied cavalry, to send in his horsemen at full gallop to break their ranks, and ordered the legionary cavalry to give support. This squall of horsemen at first unsettled and disrupted the battle line of the Gauls, and then broke it up, but without making the enemy turn in flight. The Gallic officers kept trying to prevent this, striking the backs of their panicking men with their spear shafts and forcing them back into line. But the allied cavalry rode amongst them and would not let them reform. The consul earnestly appealed to his men to put on a little more pressure, since victory was in their hands. They should press the attack as long as they saw the enemy in disorder and panic. Allowing their ranks to be reformed would mean once more fighting the battle from the start, and its outcome would be uncertain. With that, he ordered the standard bearers to take their standards forward. There was then a concerted effort by everyone which finally turned the enemy. After the Gauls turned and scattered in flight in all directions, the legionary cavalry were sent out to pursue them. There were 14,000 Boii killed that day, and 1,092 were taken alive, plus 721 horsemen and three of their officers. 212 military standards were captured and 63 wagons. But it was no bloodless victory for the Romans either. More than 5,000 soldiers, Romans and allies, were lost, plus 23 centurions, four allied officers as well, as Marcus, Janusius, and Quintus and Marcus Marcius, military tribunes of the 2nd Legion. 6. Dispatches arrived at about the same time from the two consuls, one from Lucius Cornelius, who gave an account of the battle with the Boii at Mutina, and the second from Quintus Minucius at Pisae. Minucius stated that it had fallen to him to preside over the elections, but the whole situation in Liguria was so precarious that he could not leave without such an action bringing destruction on the allies and damage to the interest of the state. If they concurred, the senators should send a message to his colleagues, telling them to return to Rome for the elections, since he had almost brought his campaign to a finish. If Cornelius objected to this on the grounds that the responsibility had not been allotted to him, he said then he, Minucius, would comply with whatever decision the Senate reached. But he continued, he entreated them to think long and hard on the question of whether resorting to an interregnum might not be more in the interest of the state than having him leave his province in such a condition. The Senate entrusted to Gaius Scribonius the task of sending two commissioners of senatorial rank to the consul Lucius Cornelius. The commissioners were to pass on to Cornelius the letter that his colleagues had sent to the Senate, and report that, if he did not come to Rome for the selection of the new magistrates, they would permit an interregnum rather than call Quintus Minucius away from an unfinished war. The commissioners on this mission brought back the answer that Lucius Cornelius would come to Rome for the selection of the new magistrates. The letter from Lucius Cornelius, which he had written after the battle with the Boii, provoked controversy in the Senate. Cornelius' legate, Marcus Claudius, had written personal letters to a number of senators saying that thanks for the successes in Cornelius's campaign were due to the good fortune of the Roman people and the courage of their soldiers, but that the consul had been responsible both for heavy Roman losses and the escape of the enemy army, which he had been given the chance of destroying. 'Losses had risen,' he said, 'because of the time taken in bringing up men kept in reserve to relieve those who were under pressure, and the enemy had slipped through the consul's fingers, because the legionary cavalry had been given the signal too late, and thus had lost the opportunity to to pursue the fugitives. 7. It was agreed that no hasty decision be made on the matter, and discussion was postponed to a time when more members would be present. In fact, there was another pressing concern at the time. The citizens were in difficulties with interest payments. Although profiteering had been checked by numerous laws relating to interest on loans, a loophole had been used to circumvent the rules by the transfer of debts to allies not covered by these statutes. And with no restrictions on interest, debtors were being crushed by their burden. A way of ending this was now sought. It was decided that the day of the Feralia, which had just passed, be set as a limit. Allies who had loaned money to Roman citizens after that date would have to make a declaration of it, and from that day the creditor would be legally bound, with regard to money on loan, to abide by the rules of whichever judicial system the debtor selected. After this, thanks to the declarations made, the size of the debt accumulated by the fraudulent practice was uncovered, and a plebeian tribune, Marcus Sempronius, made a proposal to the plebs which had been authorized by the Senate, and which the plebs now ratified, that allies and members of the Latin League be subject to the same laws dealing with loans as Roman citizens. Such were affairs in Italy, military and political. In Spain, the war was nothing like as serious as the exaggerated reports had suggested. Gaius Flaminius took the town of Eleusia in the territory of the Oritani in Hither Spain, after which he led his men to a winter quarters. Throughout the winter, there were a number of engagements, none worth putting on record, fought in response to attacks made by marauders rather than by enemy forces, though the results were uneven and not without Roman casualties. More was achieved by Marcus Fulvius, who fought a pitched battle with the Vacae, spelt capital V-A-C-C-A-E-I. More was achieved by Marcus Fulvius, who fought a pitched battle with the Vacae, Vitones, and Celebiterians near the town of Tolitum, defeating the and putting to flight the army of these tribes and taking alive their king, Halernus. 8. The day of the elections was approaching, as the events were taking place in Spain, and so the consul Lucius Cornelius left his legate Marcus Claudius in charge of the army and came to Rome, discussing before the Senate his own achievements and the situation in his province. He lodged a complaint with the senators. They had failed to pay the honors due to the immortal gods after a war of such proportions had been so successfully terminated with a single victory. Cornelius then requested that the senators decree a time of public prayer as well as a triumph. However, before the question was formally put, Quintus Metellus, a formal consul and dictator, said that conflicting letters had arrived at the same time, one from the consul Lucius Cornelius to the Senate as a whole, and another from Marcus Marcellus addressed to most of the senators. For this reason, said Metellus, discussion of the matter had been deferred so the debate could take place in the presence of the authors of those letters. The consul, he continued, was aware that negative comments had been made about him in the legate's correspondence, and he, Metellus, had therefore expected him to bring the lieutenant to Rome with him, since he had to come himself. And besides, it was more proper for the army to be confided to Tiberius Sempronius, who already held Imperium, then to Legate, then to a Legate. As matters now stood, it appeared that Cornelius had purposely kept away from the city a man who might articulate before the house the statements he had put in writing, and who could thus make his charges publicly, and face charges himself if his statements were at all misleading, until the truth of the matter had been thoroughly investigated and brought to light. It was accordingly his view that none of the consul's request should be officially granted for the moment, he said. When Cornelius continued with no less persistence to push his proposal for the authorization of public prayers and for permission to enter the city in triumph, the plebeian tribunes Marcus and Gaius Titinius declared that they would use their veto in the event of senatorial decree on the question. 9. The censors elected the previous year had been Sextus Aelius Paetus and Gaius Cornelius Cethegus, and Cornelius performed the census purification. The census of the citizens totaled 243,704. There were torrential rains that year, and the Tiber inundated the level areas of the city, even causing some buildings to collapse in ruins around the Porta Fluamantana. The Porta Caelomantana was struck by lightning, and so too was the city wall in the vicinity at several points. Showers of stones fell at Aricia and Lanovivium, and on the Aventine, the news came from Capua of a huge swarm of wasps that had flown into the Forum and settled in the Temple of Mars. These, it was reported, had been carefully collected and incinerated. Because of these prodigies, the Decemvirs were instructed to consult the books. A 9-day sacrifice was performed, public prayers ordained, and the city was purified. In this same period, Marcus Porcius Cato dedicated a shrine to Victoria Virgo near the Temple of Victoria, 2 years after he had promised it in a vow. That same year, a Latin colony was installed at Castrum Frentinum by the triumvirs Aulus Manlius Volso, Lucius Apustius Fulo, and Quintus Aelius Tubero. It was the latter's law which had been responsible for the settlement. 3,000 infantrymen and 300 cavalrymen went there, a small number in view of the quantity of land available. Infantrymen could have been awarded 30 iugera per head, and cavalrymen 60. But on the proposal of Apustius, a third of the land was set aside to be used to enlist new colonists, if that was wanted. The infantrymen were then given 20 iugera, the cavalry 40. 10. The year was now at an end, and campaigning for the consular elections had become more intense than ever in the past. Many powerful men, both patrician and plebeian, were candidates. The patricians were Publius Cornelius Scipio, son of Gnaeus Scipio, who had recently returned from his province of Spain with great achievements to his credit. Lucius Quintius Flaminius, who had been admiral of the fleet in Greece, and Gnaeus Manlius Volso, plebeian candidates, were Gaius Laelius, Gnaeus Domitius, Gaius Livius Salinator, and Manius Acilius. But the eyes of all were focused on Quintius and Cornelius, for they were both patricians seeking the same seat,
and recent military achievements lent luster to each. But more than anything else, it was the brothers of the candidates, the two most famous commanders of their time, who added excitement to the race. Scipio had the greater distinction, but that also left him more exposed to envy, and Quinctius' distinction was of more recent date, since he had celebrated his triumph that year. There was also another factor. The former man had been constantly in the public eye for almost 10 years now, which decreases the respect felt for a great man simply because of the overexposure, and had served as consul for the second time after the defeat of Hannibal, and as censor too. As for Quinctius, he could win popularity because his whole record was fresh and recent. He had asked for nothing of the people since his triumph, and had been accorded nothing. Personal footnote, that's an interesting point to make. And I never really heard it illustrated that way before. Right, when they were talking about popularity between these two, when it came to Scipio, it says the former man had been constantly in the public eye for almost 10 years now. And then hyphen, it is followed by, right, which decreases the respect felt for a great man simply because of the overexposure. And I think this statement here makes, you know, it, it's more of an observance of public opinion due to, I don't know, I want to say the stupidity of human nature, whatever. He's been around so long, I'm sick of hearing his name. It has nothing to do with the guy's credentials or whether he's capable or not. It's just people are get stupid, you know? Especially during election times. But anyway, picking up. As for Quinctius, he could win popularity because his whole record was fresh and recent. He had asked for nothing of the people since his triumph and had been accorded nothing. He kept making the point that he was canvassing for a brother, not a cousin, and for one who had been his legate and partner in the conduct of the war. He himself had campaigned on land, his brother at sea. With these assertions, he brought about victory for his brother over a candidate who had the support of Africanus, his cousin, and of the Cornelian family, with a Cornelius presiding over the election as consul, and the advantage of a great vote of confidence from the Senate, which had judged him the best man in the community to welcome the Idaean mother when she came to the city from Pacinus. Lucius Quinctius and Gnaeus Domitius Ahen Obarus were elected consuls, demonstrating how little influence Africanus had even in the selection of the plebeian consul, for he had been supporting Gaius Laelius candidacy. The next day, the following praetors were elected: Lucius Scribonius Libo, Marcus Fulvius Centumalus, Aulus Atilius Serenus, Marcus Baebius Tamphilus, Lucius Valerius Tapo, and Quintus Salonius Sara. The aedileship of that year, occupied by Marcus Aemilius Lepidus and Lucius Aemilius Paulus, was noteworthy for its holders' prosecution of many cattle breeders. From the money raised by this, they set up some gilded shields on the pediment of the Temple of Jupiter, and they constructed one portico outside the Porta Trigemina, adding a wharf on the Tiber to the end of it, and a second which extended from the Porta Fontinalis to the altar of Mars on the way down to the Campus Martius.
And again, returning to book 35, returning again to the top of the last paragraph, section 10. Lucius, Quinctius, and Gnaeus Domitius Ahenobarbus were elected consuls, demonstrating how little influence Africanus had even in the selection of the plebeian consul, for he had been supporting a Gaius Laelius candidacy. The next day, the following praetors were elected: Lucius Scribonius Libo, Marcus Fulvius Centumalus, Aulus Aetilius Serenus, Marcus Babius Tamphilus, Lucius Valerius Tapo, and Quintus Solonius Sara. The aedileship of that year, occupied by Marcus Aemilius Lepidus and Lucius Aemilius Paulus, was noteworthy for its holders' prosecution of many cattle breeders. From the money raised by this, they set up some gilded shields on the pediment of the Temple of Jupiter, and they constructed one portico outside the Porta Trigemina, adding a wharf on the Tiber to the end of it, and a second which extended from Porta Fontanalis to the altar of Mars, on the way down to the Campus Martius. 11. For a long while, there had been no activity worthy of note amongst the Ligurians, but at the end of that year, two situations arose that were fraught with danger. An attack was made on the consul's camp, and only with difficulty beaten off, and not much later, when the Roman army was being taken through a narrow defile, Ligurian troops occupied the actual opening of the pass. Since there was no way through, the consul turned the column round and proceeded to march back. To the rear, too, the mouth of the pass had been seized by a number of the enemy, and the disaster of the Caudine Forks, which they now recalled, was not only present in their thoughts, but almost danced before their eyes. The consul had approximately 800 Numidian cavalry amongst his auxiliary troops. The commander of these promised him that he would break through with his men at whichever end the consul wished. He merely had to indicate which end had the more villages, for the Numidians would attack these, and before anything else, would set light to their buildings. The panic generated by this would force the Ligurians to quit the pass which they were blockading and run off to bring help to their respective peoples. The consul applauded the man and showered him with promises of reward. The Numidians mounted their horses and rode towards the enemy outpost, but without attacking anyone. At first there could not have been a more sorry sight. Horses and men were puny and scrawny. The riders had no body armor or weapons apart from the javelins which they carried. The horses had no bridles, and their very gallop was unsightly, racing along as they did with neck stiff and head outstretched. The Numidians purposely enhanced the derision of the enemy by falling from their mounts and making themselves look ridiculous. As a result, the men in the outposts, who had been at first attentive and prepared for any attack, were now for the most part sitting around unarmed watching them. The Numidians would ride forward, then go back, but little by little they were approaching the mouth of the pass, looking like men carried off unwilling by mounts which they could not control. In the end, they put their spurs to the horses, broke through the midst of the enemy outpost, and rode out into more open country. setting fire to all the buildings bordering the road. And next, they set light to the nearest village and destroyed everything with fire and the sword. First, the smoke was sighted, then shouts from panic-stricken villagers could be heard, and finally, old men and children running in flight caused uproar in the camp. So it was that, with no plan of campaign and on no order, the Gauls all hurried off on their own to protect their own property. In a moment, the camp was left deserted, and the consul, delivered from the blockade, reached the destination for which he had been bound. 12. But neither the Boii nor the Spaniards, with whom there had been war that year, proved as hostile and threatening to the Romans as did the people of Aetolia. After the armies were shipped from Greece, and Aetolians had initially entertained two hopes, first that Antiochus would come to take possession of the now vacated Europe, and second, that neither Philip nor Nabis would remain inactive. When they saw nothing happening in any quarter, they thought they would agitate and cause some trouble so their schemes should not waste away through procrastination, and they called a meeting at Nopactus. At this, their praetor, Thoas, protested about the injuries the Romans had inflicted on them and about the plight of Aetolia, of all the Greek peoples and city-states, he said. The Aetolians had been shown the least respect following the victory, for which they had been directly responsible. He moved that envoys be sent around to the kings, not merely to test their inclinations, but actually to incite them to war with Rome, with incentives appropriate to each. Democritus was sent to Nabis, Nicander to Philip, and Dicarchus, brother of the praetor, to Antiochus. Democritus told the Spartan tyrant that his realm had been debilitated through his being divested of his maritime states, which had been the source of his soldiers, ships, and seamen. Nabis was practically confined within his own walls. Nabis was practically confined within his own walls, said Democritus, watching the Achaeans exercise control in the Peloponnese. If he let slip the opportunity now, on offer of recovering what was his, he would never have another, for there was no Roman army operating in Greece, and the Romans would not consider Githium or other coastal towns of Laconia a good reason for sending their legions into Greece once again. These statements were designed to provoke the tyrant. The aim was that, when Antiochus crossed to Greece, Nabis would be aware that he had violated his friendship with the Romans by his mistreatment of their allies, and this would lead him to join Antiochus. Philip, too, was being egged on with arguments not unlike these by Nicander, and here there was even more scope for persuasive argument, inasmuch as the king had been brought down from a higher position than the tyrant, and had suffered greater loss. Furthermore, there were references made by Nicanor to the time-honored renown of the kings of Macedonia, and the victorious campaigns of that race throughout the world. The advice he was given would be risk-free both at the outset and when it was carried through, said Nicanor. In the first place, he was not suggesting that Philip make any move before Antiochus crossed to Greece with his army. Secondly, Philip had over a very long period sustained a war against the Romans without Antiochus's help, and when Antiochus now joined him, and he now had as his allies the Aetolians, who had been a more formidable enemy than the Romans on that occasion, where could the Romans possibly find the strength to resist him? Nicander added a word about Hannibal's leadership. He had been born a foe of the Romans, he said, and had cut down more of their officers and men than now survived. Such were Nicander's comments to Philip, but those of Dicarchus to Antiochus were of a different tenor. The very first thing he said was that the booty taken from Philip had gone to the Romans, while the victory was secured by the Aetolians, for it had been the Aetolians and no one else who had given Romans access to Greece and furnished them with the strength to win their victory. He next enumerated the infantry and cavalry forces that the Aetolians would provide to Antiochus for the war and the land bases for his armies and ports for his navies. He then resorted to a barefaced lie with regard to Philip and Nabis, claiming that both were ready to restart hostilities and would seize the first possible opportunity to recover what they had lost in war. So it was that the Aetolians were simultaneously fomenting war against the Romans throughout the world. 13. The kings, however, either did not react or else reacted too late. Nabis immediately sent men around all the villages on the coast to instigate rebellion, winning a number of important men over to his cause by bribery, and putting others to death when they obstinately stood by the Roman alliance. The Achaeans had been assigned the responsibility of protecting all Spartan towns on the coast by Titus Quintius, and they at once sent envoys to the tyrant to remind him of his treaty with Rome, and to warn him against upsetting the peace he had so fervently sought. They also dispatched relief forces to Githium, which was by now under attack from the tyrant, and sent envoys to Rome to report on the situation. The winter, Antiochus gave his daughter in marriage to Ptolemy, king of Egypt, at Raphia in Phoenicia, after which he retired to Antioch. Then, crossing the Taurus range at the end of winter, he came through Cilicia to Ephesus. From here, at the start of spring, he sent his son Antiochus into Syria to oversee the most remote areas of his kingdom, so there should be no unrest at his rear while he was away, and then set off in person at the head all his land forces to make an attack on the Pisidians, who live in the area of Side Publius Sulpicius and Publius Villius, the Roman commissioners who had been sent to Antiochus as mentioned above, and being instructed to see Eumenes first, and they came to Elea at this time. From there they went up to Pergamum, site of Eumenes' palace. Eumenes was eager to go to war with Antiochus. He believed that if there were peace, a king with so much power, then himself would make a worrisome neighbor, and if war broke out, the same king would prove no more a match for the Romans than Philip had been. Antiochus would either be totally destroyed, or, if he were given peace terms after his defeat, much of what would be taken from him would go to Eumenes, who, so that he could therefore easily defend himself against Antiochus without any assistance from Rome. Even if something went wrong, he reasoned, it was better to face whatever fortune had in store for him with the Romans as his allies than to resign himself to Antiochus's domination in isolation or be obliged to do so by armed force if he refused. For these reasons, Eumenes was using all his influence in every argument he could think of to goad the Romans into war. 14. Sulpicius, who had fallen ill, stayed on at Pergamum, but Villius headed for Ephesus on hearing that the king was involved in a war in Pisidia. While he was spending a few days in the city, he made a point of having regular meetings with Hannibal, who happened to be there at the time in order to sound out his attitudes and, if he possibly could, allay his fear that he faced some threat from the Romans. Nothing was achieved by these discussions, but an incidental result of them, which might have appeared intentional, was that Hannibal began to lose his credit with the king and to become generally regarded with suspicion. Claudius, who is following the Greek account by Aecilius, records that Publius Africanus was on that delegation and that he conversed with Hannibal at Ephesus. Claudius gives an account of one of the topics of these conversations. Africanus asked who Hannibal thought had been the greatest general, and Hannibal replied that it was Alexander of Macedon, because with a small force he had defeated armies of immense proportions and penetrated to the ends of the earth, which human beings had never expected to visit. When Scipio then asked whom Hannibal would put second, his answer was that it was Pyrrhus. It was he who first taught the technique of laying out a camp, and in addition, no one had selected his terrain and deployed his troops with more finesse. He also had a way of gaining men's support, so that the peoples of Italy preferred to be ruled by a foreign king than by the Roman people, despite the latter's long hegemony in the land. Scipio went on to ask whom he considered third, and Hannibal replied that it was obviously Hannibal himself. Scipio burst into laughter and retorted, "What would your answer be if you had defeated me?" "In that case," Hannibal replied, "I should have said that I was ahead of both Alexander and Pyrrhus and all the other generals in the world." The cryptic answer, with its Punic ingenuity and this unexpected mode of flattery, had a profound effect on Scipio, according to Claudius. Hannibal had set him apart from ordinary commanders as being of incalculable worth. 15. Villius went ahead to Apamea from Ephesus, and Antiochus also came to this city after hearing of the arrival of the Roman commissioners. The discussion at their meeting in Apamea was almost identical to that which had taken place at Rome between Quintius and the king's ambassadors. The proceedings were adjourned when news arrived of the death of Antiochus's son. who, as I noted a little while ago, had been sent into Syria. There was intense grief in the palace, and the young man was sorely missed, for he had already given an indication of his character to the point of making it clear that he had the makings of a great and righteous king, had he been granted a longer lifespan. The extent to which he was loved and esteemed by everybody made the circumstances of his death all the more suspicious. It was thought that the father had used the agency of certain eunuchs, individuals who endear themselves to monarchs by performing such criminal services, to have him done away with by poison, because he believed that having such a successor waiting in the wings would be a threat to him in his old age. People also adduced the following as a motive for his treacherous act. The king had given Lysimachia to his son Seleucus, but had not had a similar capital to give to Antiochus as a means of keeping him. 2. At a distance, by apparently showing him honor. Even so, for several days there was a display of deep mourning at court, and so as not to make nuisance of himself, at this awkward time the Roman delegate repaired to Pergamum. The king abandoned the war he had started and returned to Ephesus, or pronounced Ephesus. There, with the court closed in mourning, he engaged in secret discussions with a certain Menio, who was his leading courtier. Menio had no knowledge of foreign affairs, and he based his appraisal of the king's strength on his successes in Syria or Asia. He thought the king had the superior cause because the Roman demands were totally unjustified, but he also believed he would prevail in combat. Since the king was now avoiding discussion with the commissioners, either finding it unproductive or still dazed from his recent bereavement, Minio assured him he would produce the requisite arguments to support his case, and persuaded him to have the commissioners invited from Pergamum. 16. By now, Sulpicius had recovered, and so both commissioners came to Ephesus. Minio apologized for the king's absence, and the meeting began without him. Minio then began speaking from a carefully prepared text. Romans, I see that you are using the specious pretext of liberating the Greek states, but your actions do not square with your claims, and while you have established one set of rules for Antiochus, you are following another yourselves. For in what way are the people of Smyrna and Lampsacus more Greek than those of Naples, Regium, and Tarentum, from what you exact tribute and ships under the terms of a treaty? Why do you send the praetor every year to Syracuse and other Greek cities in Sicily with imperium, the rods and the axes? The only possible reason you could give would be that you have imposed these terms on them after military victory. You must accept from Antiochus the argument that the same condition obtains in the case of Smyrna, Lampsacus, and the cities that lie in Ionia or Aeolia. These were defeated in war by his ancestors and made into tribute and tax-paying states, and now Antiochus is reclaiming his erstwhile rights to them. And so I would like a response from you on these points, if this is a fair discussion and not simply a search for an excuse for war. Sulpicius replied as follows. Antiochus has behaved with propriety, no other arguments being available to support his case. He has chosen to have anyone other than himself to present these ones. For what resemblance is there between the cases of the states which you have chosen to compare? We demand of the people of Regium Naples, and Tarentum what is owing to us by the terms of our treaty with them, and have done so ever since they came into our power, exercising our rights uninterruptedly and continuously, without a break. These peoples have never, through their own actions or anyone else's, effected any charge in their treaty. Can you say that the communities of Asia have similarly remained continuously the property of your realm since the time when they first came under the control of Antiochus's ancestors? Can you say that some have not been under Philip and others under Ptolemy, and that yet others have not reclaimed their independence without resistance or a number of years? Again, can you say that some have not been under Philip and others under Ptolemy, and that yet others have not reclaimed their independence without resistance over a number of years? Will the fact that people have been once in subservience, disadvantaged by the iniquity of a particular period of history, give others the right to enslave them when so many generations have passed? For if so, that is tantamount to saying that we accomplish nothing in liberating Greece from Philip, and that his descendants may reclaim Corinth, Chalcis, Demetrius, and the entire Thessalian people. But why am I pleading the cause of these city-states when it is more appropriate that both we and the king himself should hear it from their own presentations? 17. Sulpicius then had a summons issued to embassies from the city-states. These had been given prior coaching and instruction by Eumenes, who assumed that whatever strength was lost to Antiochus would accrue to his own realm. Several were given an audience, and as each added its own protest and demands, combining valid ones with invalid, they turned the discussion into a squabble, and so, with no concessions made or gained, the commissioners turned to Rome, unsure of anything, no further forward than when they had come. When the commissioners had left, the king held a council to discuss the war with Rome. At this, each speaker tried to outdo the other in vitriolic denunciation of the arrogant Roman demands, for they all thought that the more abusive their criticism was, the more they could hope to ingratiate themselves with the king. The Romans, they said, were imposing terms on Antiochus, the greatest king in Asia, as if he were a defeated Nabis. Yet, even Nabis had been left with sovereignty in his own country, and the country of Sparta. While it was regarded as intolerable for Smyrna and Lampsacus to rule by Antiochus, others argued that these states were of slight importance and hardly worth mentioning as reasons for so great a king to go to war. But the unscrupulous demands always began with insignificant ones, unless they really were to believe that the Persians needed a lump of turf and a drink of water, when they asked the Spartans for earth and water. The Romans were now trying the same sort of tactic with the two states in question, they said, and other states would go over to the liberating nation as soon as they saw that these two had thrown off the yoke. Even if independence were not of itself a preferable state to servitude, everyone still finds the prospect of a change of circumstances more attractive, no matter what his present situation. 18. An Arcanian called Alexander 18, an Acarnanian called Alexander, was at this meeting. He had earlier been a friend of Philip's, but he had recently abandoned him to latch onto the wealthier court of Antiochus. Knowing Greece well, and having no small acquaintanceship with the Romans, Alexander had established such a close relationship with the king as to be party to all his secret plans. For him, the question was not so much whether or not to go to war, but rather where and how to conduct it. And he would declare that he foresaw a certain victory if the king crossed to Europe and established the theater of war in some area of Greece. Antiochus would first of all find that the Aetolians, who inhabited the central point of Greece, were already up in arms. These were his forward troops, ready to face the greatest hardships of the war. On the two flanks of Greece, as it were, there would be Nabis, who would wreak sheer havoc in the Peloponnese, trying to recover the city of Argos and the maritime states from which the Romans had driven him, before they shut him up within the walls of Sparta. And there would be Philip in Macedonia, who would take up arms immediately on hearing the clarion call to war. He was personally acquainted with Philip's dynamism, and with his temperament, said Alexander, he knew that he had long been churning over fierce resentment in his heart, like wild animals that are caged or chained. He remembered how often during the war Philip would pray to all the gods to give him Antiochus as a partner. If Philip now had that prayer answered, he would not put off rebelling for a moment. Only Antiochus must not hesitate or hold back, for victory depended on forestalling their enemy in seizing strategic positions and in securing allies. He finished by saying that Hannibal should also be sent immediately to Africa to create a diversion for the Romans. 19. Hannibal was not invited to this meeting. He had aroused the king's suspicions because of his conversations with Villius, and was subsequently shown no respect by the king. Initially, he suffered this indignity in silence, but later thought it better to ask why the king had suddenly turned from him, and also try to clear himself of suspicion. Choosing an appropriate moment, he bluntly asked the king the reason for his displeasure. On being told the reason, he said, "When I was just a little boy, Antiochus, my father Hamilcar, was performing a sacrifice. He brought me to the altar and bound me under oath never to be a friend of the Roman people. I have campaigned observing this oath for 36 years. It was the oath that drove me from my country in time of peace, and this that brought me an exile from that country to your court. If you frustrate my hopes, I shall hold to this oath and go wherever I know power and military strength exist, searching the whole world over for enemies of Rome. So if any of your friends want to advance in your esteem by making allegations against me, let them find other ways of advancing at my expense. I hate and am hated by the Romans. My father Hamilcar and the gods are witness to the truth of what I say. So when you reflect on war with Rome, regard Hannibal as one of your foremost friends. But if something disposes you towards peace, look for someone else with whom to discuss that course." These words not only impressed the king, but actually reconciled him with Hannibal. The council broke up with a decision for war. 20. In Rome, people certainly had Antiochus marked out as an enemy in their conversations, but so far they were preparing nothing except their spirit for the oncoming conflict. Both councils were assigned Italy as their province, on the understanding that they arranged by mutual agreement or by lot which of them should preside over the year's elections. The one to whom that responsibility did not fall was to be ready to take the legions wherever necessary outside Italy. This consul was given permission to mobilize 2 new legions along with 20,000 infantry and 800 cavalry from the Allies and the Latin League. The other was assigned the 2 legions which had been under the command of Lucius Cornelius, consul the previous year, plus from the same army 15,000 infantry and 500 cavalry of the Allies and the Latin League. Quintius Minucius, commanding an army in Liguria, had his imperium extended, and the forces were to be supplemented by the enlisting of 4,000 Roman infantrymen and 150 cavalrymen, and by 5,000 infantry and 250 cavalry to be requisitioned for him from the Allies. The responsibility of leaving Italy for wherever the Senate decided fell to Gnaeus Domitius Gaul, and administration of elections to Lucius Quintius. The Praetorian sortition of provinces then proceeded as follows. Marcus Fulvius Centumalis, city jurisdiction. Lucius Scribonius Libo, foreigner's jurisdiction. Lucius Valerius Tapo, Sicily. Quintus Salonius Sara, Sardinia. Marcus Baebius Tamphilus, hither Spain. Aulus Atilius Serenus, farther Spain. However, the provinces of the latter two praetors were changed, first by senatorial decree, and then by a resolution of the plebs, with Attilius being assigned the fleet and Macedonia, and by Abius given Bruttium. Flaminius and Fulvius had their imperium in the Spanish provinces extended. Attilius was allocated for operations against the Bruttii, the 2 legions stationed in the city the previous year, plus 15,000 infantry and 500 cavalry that were to be requisitioned from the Allies. Baebius Tamphilus was ordered to construct 30 quinquiremes, to bring from the dockyards any old vessels that were still serviceable, and to enlist sailors. The consuls were also instructed to furnish him with 2,000 infantry from the Allies and the Latin League, and 1,000 Roman infantry. It was claimed that these 2 praetors, with their 2 armies, a land force, and a navy, were being held in readiness for operations against Nabis, who was now openly attacking allies of the Roman people. But in fact, it was a matter of awaiting the return of the ambassadors who had been sent to Antiochus, and the Senate had forbidden Gnaeus Domitius to leave the city until these came back. 21. The praetors Fulvius and Scribonius, whose area of responsibility was the administration of justice in Rome, were assigned the task of making ready 100 quinquiremes, in addition to the fleet which Baebius was to command. Before the consul and the praetors left for their provinces, public prayers were held because of a number of portents. There was a report from Picenum of a goat having given birth to 6 kids in 1 delivery, another of a birth at Arretium of a baby boy with only 1 hand, and at Amiternum there were said to have been showers of earth. At Formiae, a city gate and wall were said to have been struck by lightning, and, most frightening of all, an ox that belonged to the consul Gnaeus Domitius was reported to have spoken the words, "Rome, be on your guard." Prayers were held with regard to the other portents, but the soothsayers ordered that the ox be attentively looked after, and fed. The Tiber made a more violent attack on the city than on the occasion of the previous flood, destroying two bridges and numerous buildings, particularly in the area of the Porta Flumetana. A huge rock, which had been loosened by rainwater or else by an earthquake, too slight to be otherwise perceptible, fell from the capital into the Vicus Iugarius, crushing many people. Cattle were swept away in various parts of the flooded countryside, and farmhouses were destroyed. Before the consul, Lucius Quinctius, reached his province, Quinctius Minucius fought a pitched battle with the Ligurians in Pisan territory. He killed 9,000 of the enemy and drove the rest in scattered flight back to their camp, over which attackers and defenders fought a furious battle until nightfall. During the night, the Ligurians slipped furtively away, and at dawn, the Romans attacked an empty camp. The amount of booty found was disappointing because the Ligurians had been intermittently sending to their homes the spoils taken from the fields. Minucius then gave the enemy no respite. He advanced against the Ligurians from Pisan territory and razed their strongholds and villages with fire and the sword. Here, the Roman soldiers took an abundance of spoils from Etruria, which had been sent from there by the Ligurian raiding parties. 22. It was at about this time that the commissioners returned to Rome from the kings. They brought no information to justify opening hostilities in the near future, except against the Spartan tyrant, who, a report confirmed by the Achaean delegation, was breaking his treaty by attacking the Spartan coastline. The praetor, Attilius, was then sent to Greece with a fleet to offer protection to the allies. With no immediate threat from Antiochus in view, it was decided that the two consuls should leave for their provinces. These came into the land of the Boii, Domitius taking the most direct route from Ariminum, and Quinctius traversing Liguria, and the armies of the two consuls coming from different directions as they were, laid waste the enemy's farmlands over a wide area. At first, a few enemy cavalrymen, with their officers, went over to the consuls, to be followed by the entire Senate, and finally by all people of any means or status, some 1,500 in all. That year saw successes in both Spanish provinces. Gaius Flaminius reduced the heavily fortified and wealthy town of Lycabrum by means of siege sheds, taking alive the famous chieftain Corabilo. The proconsul Marcus Fulvius also fought two successful engagements with two enemy armies and took by storm two Spanish towns, Vesalia and Halo, plus a large number of fortresses. Other towns went over to the proconsul of their own accord. Fulvius then advanced against the Oritani, and after capturing two towns in their territory, Noliba and Cosiba, proceeded towards the river Tagus. In this area lay Tolitum, which, though a small city, enjoyed natural defenses. While Fulvius was assaulting the town, a large force of Vitones came to support the Tolitani. Fulvius successfully engaged these in pitched battle, and after routing them, took Tolitum by siege. 23. In fact, the wars in progress at this time disquieted the senators less than the prospect of war with Antiochus, which had not yet begun, although the entire situation was under repeated investigation by the commissioners. Wild and unsubstantiated rumors would still arise, and these were a mixture of truth and falsehood. One such was the report that Antiochus would send a fleet to Sicily immediately after reaching Aetolia. The Senate had already sent the praetor Attilius to Greece in command of a fleet, but because an authoritative presence and not merely armed forces was needed there to retain the loyalty of the allies, it also sent a delegation consisting of Titus Quintius, Gnaeus Octavius, Gnaeus Servilius, and Publius Vilius. There was, moreover, a senatorial decree ordering Marcus Baebius to advance his legions from Bruttium to Tarentum and Brundisium, and cross from there to Macedonia if the situation so required. The praetor, Marcus Fulvius, was also ordered by the decree to send a fleet of 20 ships to give protection to the coastline of Sicily, and the man who was to be the admiral of this fleet, in fact the admiral, turned out to be Lucius Oppius Salinator, plebeian aedile the year before, was to have imperium. Furthermore, the praetor was to write to his colleague, Lucius Valerius, to alert him to the danger of Antiochus's fleet crossing from Aetolia to Sicily, and tell him of the Senate's decision in the light of this, that he raise an emergency force of about 1,200 infantry and 400 cavalry to add to the army which he already had. With such a force, Valerius would have the capability to protect the coast of the province that faced Greece. These troops, the praetor raised, not only in Sicily itself, but also from its offshore islands, and he reinforced with garrisons all the coastal towns on the side facing Greece. The rumors were fueled yet more by the arrival of Eumenes' brother, Attalus, who reported that Antiochus had crossed the Hellespont with his army, and that such was the state of preparedness of the Aetolians that they would be under arms by the time of his arrival. Both men were thanked, Eumenes in his absence and Attalus in person. Attalus was also officially awarded state housing and entertainment, and given presents: 2 horses, 2 sets of horsemen's armor, silver vases weighing 100 pounds, and gold vases weighing 20. 24. Since messages kept arriving one after the other that war was imminent, it seemed advisable that the election of the consuls take place at the earliest possible opportunity. A senatorial decree was thus passed authorizing the praetor Marcus Fulvius to send a letter immediately to the consul. Fulvius was to inform him that it was the Senate's decision that he hand over his province and army to his officers and return to Rome, sending ahead an edict while he was on his way by which he announced the consular elections. The consul obeyed the instructions in the letter and came to Rome after sending ahead the edict. There was intense competition over that year as well, with 3 patrician candidates vying for 1 position. Publius Cornelius Scipio, son of Gnaeus Scipio, who had been defeated the previous year, Lucius Cornelius Scipio, and Gnaeus Manlius Fulso. The consulship was awarded to Publius Scipio, so that it appeared that a man of his distinction had merely had the honor deferred, not refused. As his colleague from the plebs, Scipio was given Manius Aecilius Glabrio. The next day, the following were elected praetors: Lucius Aemilius Paulus, Marcus Aemilius Lepidus, Marcus Iunius Brutus,
Aulus Cornelius Mamulla, Gaius Livius, and Lucius Oppius, the latter two both surnamed Salinator. It was this Oppius who had commanded the fleet of 20 ships that went to Sicily. In the time before the new magistrates were to draw lots for their provinces, Marcus Fabius was instructed to cross from Brundisium to Epirus with all his troops, and keep them in the vicinity of Apollonia, and the urban praetor Marcus Fulvius was given the responsibility of constructing 50 new quinquiremes. 25. In this way, the Roman people were preparing themselves for every possible move by Antiochus. By now, Nabis too was no longer postponing hostilities. He was devoting all his might to the siege of Githium and to laying waste the fields of the Achaeans, resentful at their having sent assistance to the town's beleaguered inhabitants. The Achaeans, for their part, dared not commit themselves to war before the return of their envoys from Rome, since they wished to know the will of the Senate. After the envoys returned, they called a council meeting at Sicyon, and also sent a deputation to Titus Quintius to ask his advice. At the council meeting, everybody was inclined to support an immediate opening of hostilities, but a letter from Titus Quintius recommending that they wait for the Roman praetor and the fleet gave them second thoughts. Since some of the prominent citizens remained firm in their opinion, while others thought they should follow the guidance of the man whose advice they had sought, the majority waited for Philopoemen to express his opinion. Philopoemen was then praetor, and he was the preeminent man of the time in sagacity and influence. He prefaced his remarks with the comment that the Achaeans had established a wise practice of forbidding a praetor to express his opinion at a council of war, and he bade them reach as speedy a decision as possible on what they wanted done. He assured them that their praetor would faithfully and scrupulously execute their decrees and do all he could to see that they did not regret their decision, whether it be for war or peace, to the extent that human reason could affect this. Philopoemen's words did more to influence them to commence hostilities than if he had shown a desire to lead the campaign by openly advocating it. As a result, a decision was made for war with a huge majority, but the praetor was given a free hand with regard to the timing and strategy of operations. Apart from the fact that this was also what Quintius wished, Philopoemen was himself of the view that they should await the Roman fleet, which could protect Githium by sea, and he feared that the situation would not brook delay, and that not just Githium, but even the garrison sent to defend the city might be lost, and so he launched the Achaean navy. 26. The tyrant had also put together a small fleet to prevent assistance being sent by sea to the besieged populace. This comprised 3 decked ships and a number of pinnaces and cutters, his old fleet having been surrendered by the Romans under the terms of the treaty. Wishing to put the maneuverability of these new vessels to the test, and also to have everything well prepared for the forthcoming struggle, Nabis had his crews and fighting men put out to sea each day and gave them training in mock naval battles. He thought his prospects for the siege depended upon his cutting off relief that might arrive by sea. The Achaeans' praetor was, in experience and talent, a match for any of the famous generals in the tactics of fighting on land, but he was not familiar with naval warfare. He was an Arcadian, a man from inland, who, apart from his service as commander of some auxiliary troops in Crete, was ignorant of everything outside his country. There was an antiquated quadrine that had been captured 80 years earlier when it was carrying Nicaea, wife of Craterus, from Naupactus to Corinth. The reputation of this vessel, which had once been a famous ship in a royal fleet, made an impression on Philopoemen, who ordered it brought from Aegium, despite the fact that it was rotten and decomposing with age. The flotilla had the quadrine as its flagship, with Piso of Petras, the admiral of the fleet, aboard, when it was met by the Spartan ships coming from Githium. At the first collision with a new and sturdy vessel, the old ship, which was already taking in water at every joint, immediately shattered, and all aboard her were taken prisoner. The flagship, lost all the other ships, fled as quickly as their oars could take them. Philopoemen himself made his escape in a light spy boat and did not arrest his flight until he reached Petrae. The event in no way crushed the spirit of Philopoemen, a true soldier with a breadth of experience. Quite the reverse, in fact. This failure in the unfamiliar sphere of naval operations only gave him greater hope of success in an area in which he had competence, he said, and he repeatedly declared that he would see to it that the tyrant's jubilation would be a short duration. 27. Elated by his success, and also confidently expecting to face no further peril from the sea, Nabis now decided to use strategically placed guard posts to shut off access by land as well. He withdrew a third of his troops from the blockade of Githium and pitched camp at Pleiae, spelt P-L-E-I-A-E, a spot overlooking both Leucae and Acreae, the direction in which it seemed likely his enemies would bring up their forces. Nabis had a stationary camp here, but few of his men had tents, and most of them had fashioned huts of intertwined reeds, which they had covered with leafy branches just to provide shade. Before he came into the enemy's view, Philopoemen decided to take him by surprise with a novel kind of military maneuver. He brought together some small boats to a secluded anchorage in Argive territory and manned them with light armored soldiers, Catrati, for the most part, who carried slings, javelins, and other light weaponry. Then, hugging the coastline, he sailed to a promontory close to the enemy camp, marched from the shore, following paths that he knew, and came by night to Pleiae. Again. Then, hugging the coastline, he sailed to a promontory close to the enemy camp, marched from the shore, following paths that he knew, and came by night to Pleiae. Finding the Spartan sentinels asleep, they thought they had nothing to fear in the vicinity. Philopoemen's men tossed firebrands on the huts from every side of the camp, and many were swallowed up by the flames before they realized the enemy had come, and those who had realized it could bring no help. Fire and the sword caused total destruction, with very few men escaping, the two deadly options to reach the larger camp at Githium. The enemy thus thrown into disorder, Philopoemen immediately marched ahead to raid Tripolis, in the part of Spartan territory next to the border of the Megapolis Neapolitans. Here he seized a large number of cattle and men, and left the area before the tyrant could send assistance to the country districts from Githium. Philopoemen then assembled his forces at Tegea and convened in the city a meeting of the Achaeans and their allies, which was also attended by the leaders both of the Epirotes and Acarnanians. Since his own men's confidence had now been restored after the shame of their naval fiasco, and since the enemy were in a state of panic, he determined at this meeting to march on Sparta, considering this the only way the enemy could be diverted from the siege of Githium. He first pitched camp in enemy territory at Carrhae. But on that very same day, Githium was taken. Philopoemen was unaware of this, and he moved his camp further on to Barbosthenes, a mountain 10 miles distant from Sparta. As for Nabis, after recapturing Githium, he sent off from the town with a force of light infantry, swiftly marched past Sparta, and seized a place called the Camp of Pyrrhus, spelled Pyrrhus, certain that this was the Achaeans' objective. From there, he went on to meet his enemy. Because of the narrowness of the road, the Achaeans were in a long column stretching nearly 5 miles. The rear was brought up by cavalry and by the majority of the auxiliary troops. Because Philopoemen believed the tyrant would attack his force from behind with his mercenaries, in whom he had most confidence. But two unexpected factors meeting him together threw him off balance. First, the position for which he was making had already been taken, and secondly, he could see that the enemy had come to meet his column head-on. Since his path lay over rough terrain, he could not visualize how any advance could be made without light-armored cover. 28. Philopoemen, however, was a man of extraordinary skill and experience when it came to leading a marching army and selecting positions, and he had trained himself in this in times of peace and as well as war. Whenever he was on a journey anywhere and he had reached a defile where passage was difficult, he would examine the lie of the land from every angle. He would mull over with himself when he was traveling alone, or ask of his companions when he had people with him what strategy should be employed in the event of an enemy appearing in this particular spot. What strategy if the enemy attacked head-on, or on one flank, or the other, or at the rear? The enemy, he hypothesized, could be met with the men in a regular battle line, or grouped as a column, which was not in battle order and suited only for marching. By reflecting on the problem, or by posing questions, he would work out what vantage point he would take, how many soldiers he would employ, and, a most important consideration, what kind of weapons. He would investigate where to put equipment and baggage, where to position the crowd of non-combatants, and what size and what kind of guard to use to protect them. He would ask if it was preferable to continue along the path on which he had started, or to retrace his steps, what site he should choose for a camp, and how great an area its palisade should enclose, where there was a suitable water supply, and where food and wood were to be found, where to lay the safest route when he struck camp the next day, and how his column should be organized. Philippomen had preoccupied himself with such problems and reflections from his early years, to the point that in a situation of this kind there was nothing that he had not considered. On this occasion, he first of all brought the column to a halt. He then sent up to the front his Cretan auxiliaries and the so-named Tarentine cavalry, each of whom took with him a pair of horses. Cretan also can be pronounced Cretan, of course. Then, ordering the regular cavalry to follow, he seized a rock on the banks of a torrent from which they could provision themselves with water. There he placed an armed guard around all the equipment and the camp followers, whom he brought together into a single group, and established a camp as well as the nature of the terrain permitted. Setting up tents on rough ground and a surface that was not level was a different matter. The enemy was half a mile away. Both sides, protected by some light infantry, drew water from the same stream. But before battle could be joined, as one would expect to happen when camps are close together, night fell. It was clear that the following day they would have to fight on the riverbank to defend their respective water bearers. And during the night, Philippomen stationed in a valley out of the enemy's view as large a group of Cetrati as the place could conceal. 29. At dawn, the Cretan light infantry and the Tarentine cavalry opened the fighting on the banks of the stream. The Cretan, Telenastus, was in command of his compatriots, the Megapolitan, Lycortus, of the cavalry. On the enemy side, too, there were Cretan auxiliaries and the same kind of cavalry. Tarentine provided cover for the water carriers. For some time, the battle was in doubt, since each side was fielding the same class of troops and using similar weapons. As the fight progressed, the tyrant's auxiliaries got the upper hand. They were numerically superior, and Philippomen's officers had also been ordered by him to put up only a half-hearted fight and then to fall back, drawing the enemy to the spot where the ambush was set. Nabis' men were in complete disorder as they chased the fugitives along the valley, and several were wounded or killed before they caught sight of the concealed enemy. The Cetrati had remained immobile, drawn up in such a way to the extent that the width of the valley permitted that they could take in their fleeing comrades easily between their ranks. Then they themselves rose up fresh, vigorous, and in formation to attack an enemy that was disordered and dispersed and exhausted from fatigue and wounds. There was no doubt about the victory. The tyrant's men immediately turned tail and were driven back to camp in a flight no less rapid than their earlier pursuit had been. Many were cut down or captured in the rout, and there would have been panic in the camp, too, had not Philippomen ordered the retreat to be sounded, fearing the terrain, which was broken and uneven in those parts through which he had recklessly advanced, more than he feared the enemy. Philippomen then imagined, from the outcome of the battle and from the temperament of the enemy leader, the state of alarm the latter was in at the moment, and he sent to him one of his auxiliaries, posing as a deserter. This man was to report to Nabis as a certainty that the Achaeans had decided to move forward the next day to the river Eurotas, which flows close to the very walls of Sparta. Their purpose, he was to say, was to cut this line of communications so that the tyrant had no way of retiring to the city when he wished, or of having supplies brought from the city to his camp, and also to test his men's sympathies in the hope that some could be induced to desert the tyrant. It was less a case of the deserter carrying conviction with the story than his giving the terror-stricken Nabis a reasonable excuse to abandon camp. The following day, Nabis commanded Pythagoras to stand guard with the auxiliaries and cavalry before the rampart, while he himself left with the main body of his army as if for battle, and ordered a swift advance towards the city. On seeing the rapidly moving column being hurried along the steep and narrow road, Philopoemen sent forth all his cavalry and the Cretan auxiliaries to charge the enemy on guard before the camp. When these men saw their enemies approaching and themselves abandoned by their comrades, they first tried to retreat into the camp. Then, with the entire Achaean force moving up on them in battle formation, they feared that they might be taken along with the camp, and proceeded to follow their compatriots' column already some way ahead. The Achaean Catrati immediately attacked and pillaged the camp, and the rest of their men went off in pursuit of the enemy. The road was such that it could hardly be negotiated by a column of men, even if they had no fear of an enemy. But when fighting broke out at the rear, and the spine-chilling cry from the panic-stricken men at the back reached those at the front, they all threw down their weapons and scattered into the woods bordering the road. In a trice, the way was barred by a pile of weaponry, spears for the most part, the majority of which fell point backwards, making a kind of rampart that blocked the road. Philopoemen told his auxiliaries to press ahead and continue the pursuit as best they could. Flight would not be easy for the enemy, he said, especially the cavalry, and he himself took the heavier armed troops by the more open road to the river Eurotas. Here he pitched camp at sunset, and proceeded to wait for the light infantry that he had left behind to pursue the enemy. These arrived at the time of the first watch, bringing word that the tyrant had made it back to the city with a few of his soldiers, but that the remainder, a large body of men, had scattered and were wandering unarmed throughout the woods. Philopoemen told these men to take food and rest. The others, having arrived earlier in the camp, had already taken food and a short rest to recuperate. Philopoemen immediately led out a hand-picked group of these, carrying nothing but swords, and positioned them on roads leading from two of the city gates towards Pherae and Barbosthenes, respectively, thinking that this was the way the enemy would return after their flight. He was not wrong in his judgment. While there was still some light, the Spartans made their way back by trails secluded in the depths of the forest, and when evening fell, and they caught sight of the lights in the enemy camp, they kept away from the area where these were by following concealed paths. When, however, they were beyond the camp, and they thought all was safe, they went down to the open roads. There, at many points, they were cut down or taken prisoner by an enemy lying in wait for them, in such great numbers that scarcely a quarter of the whole army escaped. With the tyrant confined to his city, Philopoemen spent some 30 days after this incident laying waste the countryside of the Spartans, returning home only when he had weakened almost broken the tyrant's power. The Achaeans now ranked him equal to the Roman commander in greatness, and even above him as far as the war with Sparta was concerned. 31. While the war between the Achaeans and the tyrant was in progress, the Roman commissioners were making the rounds of the allied cities, concerned that the Aetolians might have induced some of them to join Antiochus. They made very little effort to approach the Achaeans, thinking that because these were on hostile terms with Nabis, they could be confidently relied upon in other respects as well. They went to Athens first, then Chalcis, and from there to Thessaly. After addressing the Thessalians at a crowded assembly, they then took the road to Demetrius, where a council of the Magnesians had been called. At this, they had to be somewhat more diplomatic in what they said, since some of the leading Magnesians had turned against the Romans and were wholeheartedly supporting Antiochus and the Aetolians. This was because when news was brought that Philip's son, who was a hostage, was being returned to him, and that the tribute imposed on the king was being suspended, there were a number of false rumors in circulation, including one that the Romans were also going to restore Demetrius to Philip. Rather than see this happen, one of the leading Magnesians, Eurylochus, and some of his supporters preferred to have the Aetolians and Antiochus come on the scene to change the whole situation. The arguments employed against these people had to be such that they would ally their groundless fears, but not alienate Philip by destroying his hopes. He was in every respect more important to the Romans than the Magnesians. Thus, all that was said was the following, that the whole of Greece was in the Romans' debt for the gift of liberty, and Demetrius, more than others, since not only had a Macedonian garrison been installed there, but a palace had also been built to make sure the people had the master ever present before their eyes, but that what had been done counted for nothing if the Aetolians installed Antiochus in Philip's palace, and the people of Demetrius were obliged to recognize a king who had both new and unfamiliar to them instead of the old one whom they knew. The Magnetarch, the title the Magnesians give their chief magistrate, was at the time Eurylochus. Confident in the authority vested in him by the office, he declared that neither he nor other Magnesians ought to feign ignorance of the rumor that was abroad that Demetrius was being restored to Philip. The Magnesians, he said, should try anything and risk anything to stop that. But carried to the point of indiscretion in the fervor of his address, Eurylochus tossed out the comment that even at the moment Demetrius might look free, but in fact, everything was done in accordance with the will of the Romans. At these words, there was murmuring in various parts of the crowd, some expressing agreement and others anger that he had dared say such a thing. Quintius was so beside himself with rage that he held his hands up to heaven and called the gods to witness the ingratitude and perfidy of the Magnesians. These words struck terror in them all, and one of their leading citizens, Zeno,
a man of considerable influence, both because he led a respectable life and also because his support of the Romans had always been beyond question, begged Quintius and the other commissioners, with tears in his eyes, not to attribute one man's lunacy to the whole state. An individual was responsible for his own idiotic behavior. The people of Magnesia, he said, were indebted to Titus Quintius and the Roman people not only for their liberty, but for everything that human beings hold sacred and dear, and thanks to them, there was nothing that a person could ask of the immortal gods that the Magnesians did not have. Sooner would they furiously lacerate their own bodies, he concluded, than violate their treaty with Rome. Zeno's words were followed by entreaties from the crowd, and Eurylochus fled from the council, making for the city gate by some back streets, and then heading straight for Aetolia. For by this time, the Aetolians were revealing their intention to rebel, and were doing so more and more with every passing day. And it so happened that at that time, one of their leaders, Thoas, whom they have sent to Antiochus, had returned from his mission, bringing with him Menippus, a representative of the king. Before these men were granted an audience, they had filled everybody's ears with reports of land and sea forces, saying that a mighty host of infantry and cavalry was on its way, with elephants brought from India, and above all, something they thought would impress the crowd more than anything, as much gold being transported as could buy the Romans themselves. It was clear to Flaminius what effect such words would have in the council. For detailed intelligence of the men's arrival and their activities was being relayed to the Roman commissioners. Although hope was all but cut off, Quintius still thought it was worthwhile for some representatives of the allies to attend that meeting, men who would remind the Aetolians of their alliance with Rome and dare to speak freely against the king's envoy. It was the Athenians who seemed best suited for this purpose, both because of the regard in which their state was held and also because of their long-standing alliance with the Aetolians, and Quintius asked them to send ambassadors to the Panatolian Council. At the council, Thoas opened the meeting with a report on his embassy. Menippus was introduced after him, and he declared that it would have been best for all the inhabitants of Greece and Asia if Antiochus's intervention could have come when Philip's power was still intact. Then, he said, everyone would have retained what was his, and all would have been subject to the approval and authority of Rome. Even now, he continued, if you are simply resolute in carrying through to their conclusion the policies you have embarked upon, Antiochus will still be able, with the help of the gods and with the Aetolians as his allies, to restore the fortunes of Greece to their former position of respect, no matter how far they have declined. But this position depends on freedom, and a freedom which stands through its own strength, and is not subject to the will of another. The Athenians were the first after the king's ambassadors to be given permission to state their view. They avoided all mention of the king and simply reminded the Aetolians of their alliance with Rome and the advantages conferred on all Greece by Titus Quintius. They cautioned the Aetolians against recklessly destroying that alliance with plans too hastily conceived, saying that impetuous and foolhardy policies looked appealing at first, but were difficult to execute and dire in their outcome. The Roman commissioners, Titus Quintius included, were not far distant, and while the situation remained unchanged, they would discuss contentious issues with them rather than arm Asia and Europe for a deadly conflict. 33. The mass of those present, eager for change, were totally committed to Antiochus. They voted against even admitting the Romans to their assembly, and it was principally the older men amongst their leading citizens who, by their influence, ensured that these be given a hearing. When the Athenians reported this decision, Quintius thought he should go to Aetolia. Either he would effect some change in the situation, or the whole world would be witness to the fact that blame for the war lay with the Aetolians, and that the Romans would be taking up arms with justice and almost from necessity. When he arrived, Quintius began his address in the council with a reference to the beginnings of the Aetolian-Roman alliance and to the number of times the Aetolians had reneged on their treaty obligations. He then dealt briefly with the rights of the city-states in dispute. If these thought they had a fair claim, he said, how much better it was to send a delegation to Rome either to argue their case or to petition the Senate than to see the Roman people in a fight with Antiochus, with the Aetolians as its promoters, a struggle that would have serious repercussions for all humanity and spell ruin for Greece. And he added, no one would face the ruin brought by that war sooner than its instigators. The Romans' prophetic utterance served no purpose. Thoas and the others in his camp were heard next, to universal applause, and they managed to get a decree passed, without even adjourning the council or waiting for the Romans to absent themselves, by which Antiochus was requested to liberate Greece and arbitrate between the Aetolians and the Romans. On top of the arrogance of this decree, there was also a personal insult delivered by the Aetolian praetor, Democritus. Quintius asked him for the text of the decree, and Democritus, with no regard for the dignity of the man, said that, for the moment, he had to attend to more urgent business. He would soon give him the decree and his answer, he said, in Italy, from a camp pitched on the bank of the Tiber. Such was the lunacy that seized the Aetolian people and their magistrates at that time. 34. Quintius and the commissioners returned to Corinth, and to appear to be doing nothing themselves about Antiochus, and to be quietly waiting the king's arrival. The Aetolians held no meeting of the whole people after they let the Romans go. However, by means of their apocliti, such is the name of their venerable executive body, which is composed of select individuals, they did consider ways of fomenting revolution in Greece. The universally held view that was in the city-states, the leading citizens, and the aristocrats were for the Roman alliance and happy with the current state of affairs, while the masses and those who were dissatisfied with their circumstances wanted radical change. The Aetolians formulated a plan one day that was not just bold but downright brazen in its ambition, to seize Demetrius, Chalcis, and Sparta. Some of their leading men were sent out individually to the individual cities, Thoas and Chalcis, Alexamenes to Sparta, and Diocles to Demetrius. Diocles was aided by the exiled Eurylochus, whose flight and the reason for it was related above. Because he had no hope of returning to his homeland by any other means, Eurylochus' relatives, friends, and partisans, briefed by a letter from him, brought his children and his wife into a crowded assembly in clothes of mourning and carrying the olive branches of suppliants, and they begged those present, as individuals and as a body, not to let an innocent man who had not been condemned grow old in exile. Honest men were moved to compassion. Scoundrels and subversives, by the hope of stirring up trouble with an uprising spearheaded by the Aetolians, and they all, for their own reasons, demanded the recall of Eurylochus. The groundwork thus completed, Diocles took all the cavalry, he was the cavalry commander at the time, and set out, ostensibly, on the mission to take the exile home. He covered an enormous amount of ground, traveling day and night, and when he was 6 miles from the city, he went ahead at daybreak with 3 crack squadrons, ordering the main body of cavalrymen to follow behind. Approaching the gate, he told all his men to dismount and lead their horses by the reins. They were also not to keep ranks, appearing thus to be on a journey more than anything else. In this way, they would seem to be simply accompanying the commander rather than acting as his armed guard. Diocles then left one of the squadrons at the gate, so the cavalrymen who were following could not be shut out, and conducted Eurylochus, whom he took by the hand, to his home, passing through the town center and the forum, as many people rushed up to congratulate him. Soon the city was full of horsemen, and the key points were occupied, after which men were sent into the houses to put to death the leaders of the opposing party. So it was that Demetrius fell to the Aetolians. At Sparta, the plan was not to apply force to the city, but to catch the tyrant with a trap. He had been stripped of his coastal towns by the Romans, and at that moment was confined within the walls of Sparta by the Achaeans. It was supposed that the man who was first to assassinate him would be sure to earn nothing but gratitude from the Lacedaemonians for the act. The Aetolians had good reason to send men to Nabis. He had been plaguing them with entreaties for help to be sent since, he said, it was they who had been responsible for recommencing the war. Alexamenus was given 1,000 infantry and 30 cavalrymen, handpicked from the young men of Aetolia. These men were briefed by the praetor Democritus in the privy council of the nation which was referred to above, and told not to imagine that their mission was the Achaean War, or anything else each of them might deduce for himself. Whatever emergency plan Alexamenus might be prompted by circumstances to adopt, that plan, no matter how surprising, adventurous, or audacious it be, they must be prepared to carry out to the letter, that they must accept that this was the sole objective for which they had been sent from home. The men thus primed, Alexamenus came with them to the tyrant, who was immediately filled with hope by the arrival. Antiochus had already crossed to Europe and would soon be in Greece. Alexamenus told him, and he would fill land and sea with armaments and soldiers. The Romans were going to understand that they were not dealing with Philip, he said. Antiochus had incalculable numbers of infantry and cavalry, and just the sight of his elephants would bring victory to his army. The Aetolians were ready to come to Sparta with their entire army when the situation could call for it, but they had wanted to demonstrate the strength of their troops to the king when he arrived. Nabis should himself also take steps not to allow the troops under his command to languish in idleness in their barracks. Alexamenes continued. He should lead them out and make them undertake military exercises, sharpening their spirit and at the same time training their bodies. Practice would lighten the toil, which might even become enjoyable because of the commander's geniality and kindness. After that, the soldiers were frequently brought out to the plain before the city, close to the river Eurotas. The tyrant's bodyguards would stand at about the middle of the line, and the tyrant himself would ride before the standards, inspecting the wings, with no more than 3 cavalrymen accompanying him. Alexamenes, usually being one of them, the Aetolian troops would be on the right wing. Both those that had been earlier serving as auxiliary troops of the tyrant and the 1,000 who had come with Alexamenes. Alexamenes had now made it his practice to go around a few of the ranks with the tyrant, giving him seemingly useful advice. He would then ride over to his men on the right wing and return from there to the tyrant after apparently issuing some order required by the circumstances. On the day which he had fixed for bringing off the coup, he rode with the tyrant for only a short while before going over to his own men. He then said to the cavalrymen who had been sent from home with him, "My young warriors, the action which you have been ordered to execute with energy is now to be done and dared. Be ready in your hearts and with your hands, so that none of you hangs back from the deed which he sees me commence. If anyone falters or follows his own course instead of mine, let him know that for him there will be no going home." All shuddered with dread, remembering the orders with which they had left. The tyrant was returning from the left wing. Alexamenes told his horsemen to put down their spears and keep their eyes on their leader, and even he had to pull himself together, disconcerted as he was by pondering the magnitude of the deed before him. When Nabis came near, Alexamenes attacked, running his horse through and flinging off the tyrant. The horsemen thrust at him as he lay on the ground, and through many of their blows fell ineffectually on the cuirass. Eventually their stabbing reached his unprotected body. Before help could be brought from the middle of the line, he breathed his last. 36. At the head of all the Aetolians, Alexamenes now moved off at a rapid pace to seize the palace. While the murder was taking place before their eyes, Nabis' bodyguards were at first terror-stricken. Later, after they saw the Aetolian column heaving, they ran to the tyrant's forsaken corpse, and the men who should have defended him in life and avenged his death became merely a crowd of onlookers. There would have been no opposition had Alexamenes immediately put down his weapons, called the populace to an assembly, and delivered a speech appropriate to the occasion, keeping a large force of Aetolians under arms, but without injuring anybody. Instead, as was only right in a project begun with treachery, everything that was done combined to hasten the downfall of the guilty. The leader spent a day and a night cooped up in the palace searching through the tyrant's treasure, while the Aetolian soldiers turned to looting, as though they had captured the city they wished to appear to have liberated. The enormity of the Aetolians' conduct, and at the same time Spartan contempt for them, gave the Lacedaemonians the courage to take concerted action. Some said they should expel the Aetolians and reclaim the liberty that was cut off just when it seemed to be in the process of being restored. Others, that they should take some member of the royal family as their figurehead, to have a leader for their enterprise. There was one, Laconicus, a mere boy, who was of royal stock. He had been brought up with the tyrant's children. They put him on a horse, took up their weapons, and massacred the Aetolians as they drifted through the city. Next, they stormed the palace, killing Alexamenus, who resisted with a few of his men. The Aetolians congregated around Chalcioecus, spelled Chalcioecus, the bronze temple of Minerva, but were cut down, with only a few throwing down their arms and escaping either to Tegea or Megalopolis. These were arrested by the magistrates in these towns and auctioned off as slaves. 37. On hearing that the tyrant had been killed, Philopoemen set off for Sparta, where he found everything full of confusion and trepidation. He summoned the leading citizens and gave the kind of address that Alexamenus should have given, thus bringing the Spartans into the Achaean League. This was helped by the fact that Aulus and Tilius happened to reach Githium at the same time with 24 quinquiremes. Meanwhile, at Chalcis, Thoas had nothing like the success which attended Eurylochus' taking of Demetrius. He had been assisted by Euthymedes, a prominent citizen who, after the arrival of Titus Quintius and the commissioners, had been driven out of the city by the authority wielded by a group supporting the Roman alliance, and also by Herodorus, a merchant who, though from Cius, was powerful at Chalcis because of his wealth, and he had, with the help of these men, primed the supporters of Euthymedes to betray the city to him. Euthymedes went from Athens, which he had chosen as his place of residence, first to Thebes and then to Salganus, while Herodorus proceeded to Thronium. Not far from Thronium, in the Malian Gulf, Thoas had 2,000 infantry, 200 cavalry, and about 30 light transport vessels. Herodorus was instructed to take the ships and 600 of the infantry over to the island of Atalante, so that he could advance from there with them to Chalcis, on learning that the land forces were approaching Aulis and Euripus. Thoas himself proceeded to take the rest of the troops as quickly as he could to Chalcis, marching mostly at night. Yeah, the pronunciation I'm not sure of, but I don't know. I suppose Herodorus could be also pronounced much like Herodotus, but in the pronunciation of Herodorus. You decide. 38. After Euthymedes' expulsion, supreme authority at Chalcis lay with Mycythio and Xenoclides, who either themselves suspected what was happening or had the plot betrayed to them. At first they panicked and placed no hope in any course of action other than flight. Then, as their fear abated and they came to see that it was not simply their country that they were letting down and abandoning, but also the alliance with Rome, they fastened upon the following plan: the annual festival of Diana, Amaranthus, happened to be taking place in Eritrea, spelt Eritria, at that time. And this is observed not only by a band of local devotees, but by others from Charistus as well. Mycenaeo and Xenoclides sent men to this festival to beg the Eritreans and Charistians to have compassion on their misfortunes. They were, after all, born on the same island, and also to have respect for the Roman alliance. They asked them not to allow Chalcis to fall to the Aetolians, who would possess all Euboea if they took Chalcis. The Macedonians had been hard taskmasters, they said, but the Aetolians would be much harder to bear. It was consideration for the Romans that, more than anything else, carried weight with the two states, which had recently been witnesses to their valor in war, as well as their fairness and generosity in victory. They both, therefore, put under arms their best men of military age and sent them into action. The citizens of Chalcis entrusted the defense of their walls to these troops, and themselves crossed the Euripus with all their forces, encamping at Salgeneus, Euripus spelled as it sounds, I guess, Euripus. From there, the Aetolians were sent first a herald and then ambassadors to ask what it was the people of Chalcis had said or done to justify their allies and friends coming to attack them. The leader of the Aetolians, Thoas, replied that they were coming not to attack them, but to liberate them from the Romans, for they were now bound with fetters more ornate and much more weighty than when they had a Macedonian garrison in their citadel. The Chalcidians, however, declared that they were slaves to no one, and that they had no need of anyone's protection. With that, the ambassadors left the meeting and returned to their people. Thoas and the Aetolians had placed all their hopes in taking them with a surprise attack, and since they were in no position to mount a conventional campaign and invest a city that had land and sea defenses, they went home. On hearing that his countrymen were encamped at Salgeneus and that the Aetolians had left, Euthymetus himself went back from Thebes to Athens. Herodorus, who had been eagerly but vainly awaiting a signal from Atalante for a number of days, sent out a spy vessel to find out what was delaying matters, and after he saw that the operation had been abandoned by the allies, he headed back to Thronium, his point of departure. 39. As for Quinctius, who was coming from Corinth by sea, when he heard what had transpired, he met Eumenes in the Euripus of Chalcis. It was there decided that 500 men would be left at Chalcis by Eumenes to form a garrison, and that the king himself should proceed to Athens. Quinctius continued to Demetrius, his original destination. He believed that the liberation of Chalcis would, to some extent, favorably dispose of the Magnesians toward resuming their alliance with Rome, and to ensure that his supporters there had some protection, he wrote to the chief officer of the Thessalians, Eunomus, asking him to put his fighting men under arms. He also sent Vilius ahead to Demetrius to sound out the sentiments of the people, determined not make a move unless some portion of them were in favor of respecting the old alliance. Vilius sailed to the harbor mouth in the Quinquirim, and when all the Magnesians poured out in a mess to the spot, he asked them whether he had come to friends or to enemies. It was their choice. The Menectarch Eurylochus replied that he had come to friends, but he added that Vilius should keep away from the harbor, allowing the Magnesians to live in harmony and liberty, and not using the pretext of meeting to inflame the masses. It then became a slanging match rather than a discussion, with the Roman berating the Magnesians as ingrates and predicting imminent disaster, and the Magnesian populace hurling strident accusations variously at the Senate and at Quintius. His initiative a failure, Vilius beat a retreat to Quintius, who then sent a message to the praetor to take his forces home and himself return to Corinth with his fleet. 40. I have, as it were, been taken off course by these events where Greek and Roman history converge, and not because the narration of them was worthwhile of itself, but because they represented the causes for the war with Antiochus. When the new consuls had been designated, which was the point at which I began my discretion, the consuls Lucius Quintius and Gnaeus Domitius left for their provinces, Quintius going to the Ligurians and Domitius against the Boii. The Boii remained pacified, even their senate, together with their children and their cavalry commanders, along with their troops, surrendered to the consul, a total of 1,500 people. The Ligurian countryside was plundered far and wide by the other consul, and several fortresses were captured. These not only yielded booty of all kinds and captives along with it, but also saw the recovery of a number of Roman citizens and allies who had been in the hands of the enemy. In that same year, a colony was established at Vibo following a decree of the Senate and its ratification by the plebs. This comprised 3,700 infantry and 300 cavalry under the direction of the triumvirs Quintus Naevius, Marcus Minucius, and Marcus Furius Crispus. Infantrymen were each given 15 iugura of land, a cavalryman receiving twice that amount. The land had most recently belonged to the Bruttii, and the Bruttii had taken it from the Greeks. In this period, there were two particularly terrifying incidents at Rome, one of which lasted longer than the other, but was not as damaging. There were earth tremors for 38 days, and these suspended business for the same number of days, which were spent in the atmosphere of anxiety and fear. A three-day period of public prayer was held because of the phenomenon. The other event was not a false alarm, but represented actual destruction for many people. A fire broke out in the cattle market, and buildings along the Tiber bank burned for a day and a night, with all the shops in the district and expensive merchandise going up in flames. 41. It was now almost the end of the year, and everyday rumors of war with Antiochus were mounting, as were the concerns of the Senate. Accordingly, the assignment of the spheres of duty to the newly elected magistrates began to be muted, so that these could all apply themselves more diligently to them. The senators decided that the areas of the consuls should be Italy, and wheresoever the Senate voted. And everyone knew that this meant the war against Antiochus. The consul, who should find himself allotted this area, was allocated 4,000 Roman infantrymen and 300 cavalry, plus 6,000 infantry and 400 horse from the Allies and the Latin League. The consul, Lucius Quinctius, was instructed to raise these troops so there would be nothing to delay the new consul's immediate departure for whatever destination it was that the Senate voted for him. A decision was likewise made on the areas of responsibility of the praetors. The first of these was to be a twofold jurisdiction, city affairs and citizen foreigners affairs. The second was bruttium. The third, the fleet, which was to sail wherever the Senate decided. The fourth, Sicily. The fifth, Sardinia. And the sixth, farther Spain. The consul, Lucius Quinctius, was also given the order to raise 2 new legions of Roman citizens and 20,000 infantry and 800 cavalry from the Allies and the Latin League. The Senate allocated this army to the praetor to whom the province of Bruttium should fall. That year, 2 temples of Jupiter were dedicated on the Capitol. They had both been promised in vows made by Lucius Furius Purpureo, the first when he was praetor in the Gallic War, the second when he was consul, and they were dedicated by the Duumvir Quintus Marcius Ralla. A large number of harsh judgments were passed on usurers that year, with private citizens being prosecuted by the curule aediles, Marcus Tusius and Publius Iunius Brutus. The fines imposed on those condemned paid for some gilded 4-horse chariots, which were installed on the Capitol, and 12 gilded shields, which were placed in the inner chapel of the Temple of Jupiter, above the pediment. The same aediles were also responsible for building a portico outside the Porta Trigemina in the carpenter's quarter. While the Romans were busy with preparations for the new war, Antiochus was not wasting his time either, but 3 city-states were holding him back: Smyrna, Alexandria, Troas, and Lampsacus. Up to that point, he had been unable to take them by assault or inveigle them into an alliance by offering terms, and he did not want to leave them to his rear as he himself crossed over into Europe. He was also detained by the question of Hannibal. First of all, there was a delay with the open-decked ships which Antiochus had been going to send to Africa with him. And then there had been some questions raised, principally by Thoas, the Aetolian, as to whether Hannibal should be sent at all. Thoas brought the news that there was total chaos in Greece, and that Demetrius was in his hands, and just as he had raised the expectations of many in Greece by lies about the king and by greatly overestimating the size of Antiochus's forces, so he now used the same routine to build up the king's hopes. Everyone was praying for Antiochus to come, he said, and people would rush to the beaches from which the royal fleet had been sighted. Thoas even made so bold as to challenge the king's decision on Hannibal, by now almost settled in his mind. He opined that the king should not detach a number of ships from his fleet, and further suggested that if ships had to be sent, then the last man to be put in command of that fleet was Hannibal. He was an exile and a Carthaginian, said Thoas, and a man whose circumstances or character could conjure up for him 1,000 new schemes a day. Further, that military reputation of his, which, like a dowry for a woman, made Hannibal a real catch. That was too great for a king's officer. It was the king who should have center stage, the king who should be seen as the sole admirable. It was the king who should have center stage, the king who should be seen as the sole admiral and sole commander. If Hannibal should lose the fleet or the army, the damage would be just the same as if these were lost by another general. But in the event of success, the glory would go to Hannibal, not Antiochus. In fact, if they were fortunate enough to inflict defeat on the Romans in the war as a whole, what hope was there of Hannibal living under a king, subject to the one individual, when he had scarcely tolerated the authority of his native land? His behavior, from his early years, with his hopes and ambitions embracing worldwide supremacy, had not been such as to suggest that he would tolerate a master in his old age. The king had no need of Hannibal as a commander, but he could use him as a courtier and advisor for the war. A limited employment of such a talent would do no harm and be not unprofitable, but if the greatest services were requested of Hannibal, these would be detrimental both to the giver and the receiver. A 43. No personalities are as susceptible to jealousy as those of men whose strength of character does not measure up to their pedigree or status, because these people hate quality and merit in another. The project of sending Hannibal, the one sound plan that had been devised at the start of the war, was immediately abandoned, particularly encouraged by Demetrius's defection to the Aetolians from the Romans. Antiochus decided to put off no longer his advance into Greece. Before setting sail, he went inland from the coast to Ilium in order to sacrifice to Minerva. Then, rejoining his fleet, he set off with 40 decked and 60 open decked ships and 200 transport vessels, carrying all manner of provisions as well as military equipment, followed behind. He first put in at the island of Imbros and crossed from there to Skiathos. Here he brought together the vessels that had been scattered at sea and then sailed on to Ptelium, his first landfall on the mainland. At Ptelium, he was met by the Magnetarch Eurylochus, and by leading Magnesians from Demetrius, he was delighted to see so many of them, and the following day he sailed with his fleet into the harbor of their city, disembarking his forces close by. These comprised 10,000 infantry, 500 cavalry, and 6 elephants, an armament barely sufficient to seize an undefended Greece, let alone sustain a war with Rome. On receiving the news that Antiochus had reached Demetrius, the Aetolians convened an assembly and passed a decree inviting him to join them. By now the king had left Demetrius because he knew the Aetolians would pass the decree and had advanced into the Malian Gulf to Phalara. After receiving the decree, he came from Phalara to Lamia, where he was given a very warm welcome by the populace, with clapping and cheering and other displays of extravagant rejoicing, typical of the common mob. 44. When they came to the assembly, it was only with difficulty that the king would be ushered in by the praetor Phinehas and the other leading Aetolians. Then silence fell upon Antiochus, began to speak. He began his address with an apology for having come with forces so many smaller than everybody had been hoping for and expecting. That, he said, should be taken as the best testimony to the strength of his good will towards them. Unprepared in all respects, and at an unseasonable time of year for sailing, he had promptly acceded to the appeal of their envoys, and had believed that when the Aetolians saw him, they would consider that in his person alone lay all they needed for their protection. Nevertheless, he would amply fulfill the hopes of those whose expectations seemed temporarily frustrated. As soon as the early months of the year made the sea navigable, he would fill the whole of Greece with men, arms, and horses, and the entire coastline with his fleets. And he would spare no expense and shirk no effort or danger until the yoke of Roman domination had been removed from their shoulders, and he had made Greece truly free, and made the Aetolians leaders within it. Provisions of all kinds would also come from Asia with his armies, he said, but for the moment the Aetolians should see to it that his men were furnished with grain supplies and other commodities at a reasonable price. After speaking to this effect, and receiving loud applause from all his listeners, the king departed, and after he left, an argument broke out between two of the principal Aetolians, Phinehas and Thoas. Phinehas expressed the view that rather than make Antiochus commander-in-chief in war, they should use him to restore peace and arbitrate their differences with the Roman people. His coming and his regal presence, said Phinehas, would be more effective than armed might in winning the Romans' respect. To avoid the necessity of going to war, men freely make many concessions, which war and force of arms could not wring from them. Thoas claimed that Phinehas was not really after peace, but merely wished to obstruct the preparations for war. He wanted the king's drive to peter out through Innui, and the Romans to have time to prepare themselves. Experience had shown clearly enough, he said, after all their delegations to Rome and all the discussions with Quintius himself, that no justice could be obtained from the Romans. The Aetolians would not have asked for Antiochus's help, he said, had not all hope been cut off for them. This help had now been offered from sooner than anyone had expected, and they must not slacken their efforts. Rather, because the king had come to them in person as the champion of Greece, the most important point, they should ask him to send for his land, the sea forces as well. In arms, the king would gain some concessions. Without arms, he would have no influence at all to further the Aetolian cause, or even his own interest with the Romans. This was the view that won the day. They voted that the king should be appointed commander-in-chief, and chose 30 leading Aetolians that could consult on any matter he wished. 46. With that, the council adjourned, and the assembled members dispersed to their various city-states. The next day, the king began consultation with the Apocliti on where hostilities should begin. The best option seemed to be to start with an attack on Chelsea's. Object of the recent unsuccessful maneuver by the Aetolians, and for that speed was what was required rather than a powerful drive and extensive preparations. The king, therefore, set off through Phocis with 1,000 infantry, which had followed him from Demetrius, and the Aetolian leaders, calling up a few of their soldiers, took another route, met him at Chaeronea, and then followed him in 10-decked ships. The king pitched camp at Selganius, and together with the Aetolian leaders crossed the Euripus by ship. When he disembarked not far from their port, the Chalcidian magistrates and leading citizens came out before the gates of the city. A small number from both sides met to discuss the situation. The Aetolians made a serious effort to persuade the Chalcidians to accept the king as their ally and friend, while at the same time preserving their alliance with Rome. The king, they said, had crossed to Europe, not to make war, but to effect the liberation of Greece, a genuine liberation, and not one that was all talk and show, such as the Romans had provided. In fact, he said, there was nothing more advantageous for the city-states of Greece than to espouse friendships with both parties, for in this way they would always be assured of the protection of one against aggression on the part of the other. They should consider the immediate consequences of not receiving the king when Roman assistance was far away, and Antiochus, whom they had not the strength to resist themselves, was at their gates as an enemy. In answer to this, one of the leading citizens of Chalcis, Mesitheo, said he wondered for whose liberation it was that Antiochus had left his realm and crossed from Europe. There was not a single state in Greece that he was aware of which had a garrison or paid tribute to Rome, or which endured laws it did not want through the obligations of a one-sided treaty. The people of Chalcis, therefore, needed no more to win their freedom for them, for they were free and needed no protection, since thanks to the Roman people of whom they spoke, they had peace and their freedom. It was not a question of their rejecting friendship with the king or with the Aetolians themselves. The latter's first gesture of friendship, he said, would be to quit their island and withdraw, for, he concluded, the Chalcidians were determined not to welcome them within their walls and not even to conclude any alliance without the approval of the Romans. 47. The king had remained at the ships, and the discussion was reported to him there. Since he had not come with sufficient forces to take forceful action, he made the decision to return to Demetrius for the time being. Here, since their first endeavor had come to nothing, the king conferred with the Aetolians on what the next step should be. They decided to approach the Boeotians, the Achaeans, and Amenander, king of the Athamanians. They believed that the Boeotian people had been at loggerheads with the Romans ever since the death of Brocalles and its aftermath, and the Philopoemen, the leading Achaean, was ill-disposed to and hated by Quinctius, because the two had been rivals for honor and glory in the Spartan campaign. As for Amenander, he had a wife, Epama, daughter of a certain Alexander of Megalopolis, who claimed descent from Alexander the Great, and who had given the names Philip and Alexander to his two sons, and Apama to his daughter. The daughter had gained fame through her royal marriage, and her elder brother, Philip, had gone with her to Athamania. This man happened to be an egotistical character, and the Aetolians and Antiochus had led him to hope to succeed to the throne of Macedon. He was indeed of royal stock, they said, if he brought Epaminondas and the Athamanians to join Antiochus. And these empty promises of theirs carried weight not only with Philip, but with Epaminondas as well. 48. In Achaia, the ambassadors of Antiochus and of the Aetolians were granted a hearing at a council in the presence of Titus Quintius. And Antiochus' ambassador was heard before the Aetolians. Like most men whose living comes from a king's resources, he simply blustered, making out with empty rhetoric what that seas and lands would be filled with troops. A countless force of horsemen was crossing into Europe by the Hellespont, he said. Some of these were men wearing breastplates and so-called cataphractae. Others were warriors who fired arrows from horseback, and something against which there was no effective defense found their mark more accurately when they had turned their horses in flight. Even if the armies of the whole of Europe were brought together, they could be crushed by these cavalry forces. But the ambassador nevertheless kept adding to the list troops of infantry, one after the other, trying to intimidate his audience with the names of races hardly ever heard in conversation, referring to the Dahae, I guess that's how you pronounce it, spelled Dahae, Medes, Elamians, and Cadousians. Then there were the naval forces, which none of the Greek harbors was large enough to accommodate. On the right wing were sailors of Sidon and Tyre. On the left, the Arradians and Sudetans from Pamphylia, races that no others have ever matched in skill or prowess at sea. It was, he said, unnecessary by now to talk of money or of other resources for the war. The Achaeans well knew themselves that the kingdoms of Asia had always been awash with gold, so the Romans would be dealing not with Philip or Hannibal, one the leader of the single state, the other limited merely to the territory of the kingdom of Macedonia. No, they would be dealing with a great man who was king of all Asia and part of Europe. Even so, although he was coming from the farthest bounds of the east to liberate Greece, Antiochus made no demand on the Achaeans that would compromise their loyalty to the Romans, their earlier allies and friends. He was not asking them to take up arms with him against the Romans, but simply to join neither side. The Achaeans said the ambassador should wish for peace for the two parties, as was appropriate for friends standing between the two, and not take part in the war. The request of Archidamus, the representative of the Aetolians, was much the same, namely that the Achaeans follow the easiest and safest course and remain at peace, watching the conflict and waiting to see how the fortunes of others turned out without putting their own at risk. Then the outspokenness ran away with them as he descended to insults both of the Romans in general and of the Quintius in particular. The Romans, he said, showed no gratitude, and he sneeringly claimed that not only their victory over Philip, but Even their survival was achieved through the courage of the Aetolians, that it was by them that Quinctius himself and his army had been saved. What responsibility of a commander had Quinctius ever discharged? He asked. He had seen him in the battlefield taking the auspices, said Archimedes. Archidamus, and making offerings and offering vows, like some little priest that sacrificed. Well, Archidamus was throwing his body in the way of the enemy's weapons on his behalf. In reply, Quinctius commented that Archidamus had taken into account those present at his address more than those of whom the address was directed. For he said, Achaeans were well aware that all the pugnacity of Aetolians lay in talk, not action, and was more apparent in their meetings and assemblies than on the battlefield. As a result, Archimedes had not been much concerned with the opinion of the Achaeans, aware as he was that he and the Aetolians were well known to them. It was at the envoys of the king, and through them at the absent king, that his ranting had been directed. If anyone had been unaware earlier of what it was that had brought Antiochus and the Aetolians together, it could have been easily seen in what their delegates said. By lying to each other and boasting of strength that they did not possess, they really managed to fill each other with false expectations. These men maintain that it was they who were responsible for Philip's defeat, and it was by their courage that the Romans were protected, Quinctius continued. And as you heard just now, they say that you and the other states and peoples will subscribe to their views. The king, on the other hand, boasts of his clouds of infantry and cavalry, and of seas covered with his fleets. It very much reminds me of the dinner party to which I was invited by a Chalcidian friend of mine, a good man and a refined dining companion. It was the summer solstice, and we were given a cordial welcome by him, but we expressed our surprise at where he had been able to find such a variety and such an abundance of game at that time of year. The man, not boastful like them, smiled and said that all those different meats that looked like wild game were thanks to the seasonings actually made from domesticated pig. This, he said, could be appropriately said of the king's troops, the subject of boasting a little earlier. The different kinds of arms, the many names of nations they had never heard of, the Dihai, the Medes, the Cadousians, and the Elymaeans, these are only Syrians, all of them, who made much better slaves than soldiers because of their servile nature. And, Achaeans, he continued, I wish that I could set before your eyes the picture of the great king running from Demetrius at one time to the council of the Aetolians at Lamia, at another to Chalcis. In the king's camp, you would see what was scarcely the equivalent of 2 undermanned legions, and you would see the king in various poses, practically begging the Aetolians for grain to distribute to his troops, or requesting a loan with interest to pay them, or standing at the gates of Chalcis, and then shut out of the city, returning to Aetolia, having done no more than take a look at Aeolus and Euripus. They both made a mistake, Antiochus in trusting the Aetolians, and the Aetolians in believing the king's empty promises. All the more reason for you not to be taken in. Rather, you should trust in the good faith of the Romans, which you have already experienced and put to the test. For the course which they maintain is the best, namely, non-intervention in the war. Nothing, in fact, is so contrary to your best interest. Earning no gratitude and no consideration, you will become the prize of the victor.